Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This program was recorded live on campus as part of Visions and Voices, the USC Arts and Humanities Initiative.
As Karen Finley so beautifully puts it, we are all members of the Black Sheep tribe, and we are here for you. So it's a pleasure to have you here at USC. Welcome back to Los Angeles.
Yeah, I know. I love it.
Suzan-Lori used to live in Venice.
I used to live in Venice.
I used to walk by your place as a kind of stalker.
That's why I moved. Now you don't know where I am.
Now I don't know where you are. Shoot. And I also maybe wanted to start a little bit tonight by acknowledging, we were talking about just a wave of what's going on in our industry, which is my mentor, Gordon Davidson, passed away on Sunday. Mm-hmm. And Gordon was a huge fan of Suzan-Lori's, and I had the great pleasure of being one of those people on the team who got to produce Topdog, Underdog at the Taper Pulitzer Prize winning play. And so I just want to acknowledge Gordon's passing, Zelda Fitchhandler, really sort of the makers of this regional theater movement. And as we were talking just a few minutes backstage, was that what that was?
That was backstage.
The tea room, we're going to call it. We were talking also about the Signature Theater and James Houghton. We just lost James Houghton. And Suzan-Lori is just about to begin one of the most amazing experiences, I think. The Signature Theater is giving an entire season over to this amazing writer to revisit her work, which is going to be extraordinary. And I was thinking maybe one way of just starting to talk is, could you tell us, first of all, what you're doing? Because you've already started on a play that you wrote a long time ago.
A long time ago. The first play in the season is The Death of the Last Black Man in the Whole Entire World, which now, as of a few days ago, I gave it an additional title because that title was not long enough. Hanging out with the actors and feeling the amazing, amazing energy and brilliance that they're bringing to it, and Liliana Baines-Cruz, who's directing it. It's a great team. And Paige Evans, who's the new artistic director. Awesome, awesome team. But I'm feeling all that good energy, and I'm thinking, oh, it needs another title, a new title, an additional title, which is The Negro Book of the Dead. So now it's The Death of the Last Black Man in the Whole Entire World, a.k.a. The Negro Book of the Dead. So that's the title of the play. And it's cool. It's kind of like a jazz slam poetry event. And when I wrote it in 1989, whatever, and we did it first at Baca downtown in Brooklyn, and then Liz Diamond directed what I consider so far the definitive production at Yale. We had an awesome group of actors, but really, like, nobody walked into rehearsal first day knowing how to do it, right? Everybody was like, and you had the experience, right? Where they're like, this is like that. And so the whole experience is like kind of, you know, getting them into it. This time we auditioned maybe 200 actors, whatever, right? Every single person came in, boom! They could just and I was like, oh shit, the culture has caught up to the play in such a cool way, you know? So now we're moving forward from there, and it's very beautiful.
Is it weird to go back and look at this work or to re-examine it? Are you rewriting it? Are you reimagining it?
I'm gonna add a few words here and there. Not a lot of rewriting. Really loving sort of what they're bringing to it. So I'm not sort of muddling, you know, in it with my writing process. I'm sort of more there as a, I don't know what you call it, like a shepherdess or whatever. Mm. You know, sort of I've never done it. When Jim Houghton said, Suzan-Lori, I want you to have a residency one, that's what they call it, at Signature. Whatever it was, 8 months ago or whatever, 10 months ago, I said, nah. Mm-mm. I don't want one. He said, come on, it will be really meaningful for you to look back on your work. I said, nah, I'm looking forward. I got a lot of new things I'm working on. And then, of course, I looked at him and realized, oh, right, he's not well. And I stopped listening to myself and listened to the bigger, more important voice in the room, which was his at that moment. And I said, right, I'll do it. And I really wasn't thinking that it was going to be such an amazing thing. But we're only like a week and a half in rehearsal, and it's like, oh my God, this is amazing. So it's a lovely gift that he has given me, and then we'll just carry forward to everybody.
And do you feel like that language that you're looking at from so long ago,
right,
in a way, going back to that language kind of does move you forward? Or does it feel like, oh, this feels like maybe a museum piece? Or does it feel like something very active and alive for you?
It's really active and alive, because the title, The Death of the Last Black Man in the Whole Entire World, a.k.a. The Negro Book of the Dead, you know, It's like a pillow. I'm going to use little props here. It's not just horizontally significant. It's vertically significant because it bisects with now and what we're going through in this country and all over the world, really, with who, basically the question, what I distill to the question of, who are you to me? Mm. Who are you to me anyway? That's the question. And so the actors, they're of African descent. They're 10, 12, I can't remember, the whole room full of people. We're all sort of asking that question to each other, to ourselves, to, you know, so it's so, what a time to do that, this play again.
Yeah, so talking about, we were talking backstage also about the times, right?
And
you talked about a very ambitious period we're in, right. And how you move forward through that period. Do you think about that a lot when you're writing? Is that the present? When you're like, it's interesting to me that mm-hmm. your most current play, Father Comes Home from the War,
right,
goes back, but it's really
right.
told in a kind of vernacular that feels very current.
Mm-hmm.
Are you thinking about modern politics when you're writing pieces that look back, or are you looking ahead only? Or looking
no, well, yeah, well, that's the thing about looking. If you look ahead with clarity, you will see everything. I mean, like now, if you're in the present moment, everything is contained in the present moment. So, sure, I'm looking back into Father Comes Home from the War, 1860, parts 1, 2, and 3, 1860s in America. I'm looking back, I'm looking backwards, and really working on looking with clarity. And when you do that, you see now, and you see the future, not because you're a soothsayer, you know what I'm saying, but because you're just looking with clarity and honesty, which is why there's a part in The Death of the Last Black Man in the Whole Entire World where the black man who is dying says, oh, I can't breathe. And the actors are like, whoa, how'd you see that, sister? And I'm like, I'm just looking with clarity. It's nothing, you know.
Well, there is an act. Yeah. You made me want to lean forward all of a sudden.
I'm sorry.
I like this.
Back,
it got me excited. There is something about this soothsayer quality, though, that makes me think about Tony Kushner in Homebody Kabul.
Right.
How did he know that, right? And in the same way, there is something about if you are looking at the culture,
right,
and you are looking at politics, and you are an artist,
right,
and you're looking at from off in the sides or
right.
not in the center, you're
mm-hmm.
able to
mm-hmm.
see a lot of. Does that happen a lot for you when you?
Well, sure. I think it happens for those of us who are brave enough to engage in the world. You know, who will look the world in the eye and say, you know, we are here, or not say anything. Sometimes we just look at the world in the eye and we listen, and we say, tell me. You know, that's what I mean. I don't know how you write, but I, so much of my writing is tell me what you have to say. I hold my hand up. It's such a strange how gestures, you know, but because I hear voices mostly from the left. So when I do that, I'm actually, it's, you know, tell me, let me hold your hand, spirit. Guide me, I'm listening, I'm here. What do you have to tell me? You know, so it's not, a lot of writers write like, me, 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 that's their first note. you know, they're like, I have something to say and I'm gonna say it, and that character in the play, that's me, and here I am talking. And it's like, great, I mean, and a lot of great plays have been written like that. Don't get me wrong, a lot of, you know, there are great plays like that. But I like the play, I mean, no, really, I mean, I can't think of one off the top of my head, but. No, I'm kidding. But I like the playwright who, or the artist who says, you know, us, or we are here, like Horton, you know, listening. And that's kind of more my style.
Which kind of invokes the sacred and it feels like we get into the spirit in some way. And that, does, do you think along those lines? Do you think of yourself as
I got these in LA when I lived out here. The plan was to get them all the way up my arm in bigger and bigger font, but I thought three is good. Like who said Emerson? Simplify, simplify, simplify. He could have said it just once, simplify, but he said it three times. So this is the same word three times. It's a word in Sanskrit, and if anybody speaks Sanskrit or is a Sanskrit scholar, please forgive me. Ishvara Pranadhanani Va, which in my horrible translation means go with the flow, or literally submit your will to the will of God. 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 See, it's loud enough. So whenever you don't know what to do, you know, it's just a joke. So there's no watch on my arm. So what time it is? It's time to go with the flow. It's a joke. It's time to hold the hand of the Spirit. So all this is like, you know.
Oh my God.
And spirituality, we know, isn't different from religion, which is a whole other subject.
But it also seems that you listen in a kind of religious way, right? That you're opening yourself up to language, to the environment, to the community,
to the ritual.
And what is your ritual? Do you have I studied with many of us in this room.
Yeah.
Studied with Irene Fornes, and you know, with Irene, there was an altar, and there was yoga, an hour of yoga, hour of writing, hour of reading.
Nice.
I didn't do it well, but.
So I have a sacred place to write, which happens to be my dining room table in a very small New York one-room apartment. I have a spouse, a husband, and I have a 5-year-old son. And so my ritual is I sit there while my son is running around the room. And my husband is working on something because he's a computer nerd, coding something. I'm like, that's my ritual. I sit down, I sit at my spot, and I show up. That's my ritual. So it's simple, real simple, right? Keep it simple. I mean, I think Irene's, like brilliant. I wish I could have such a gorgeous ritual to write. I just make sure if I show up, if I have a problem with my work, my writing, I always ask myself, instead of going, oh, I have a problem because the producers aren't treating me right or the actress isn't. No. Am I showing up for my work? Am I showing up? Are you showing up, Suzan-Lori? If the answer is no, that's the root of the problem. So I make sure that I show up, and it doesn't have to be a long swath of time. Sometimes we say, I'll write that novel when I get that residency at that fabulous place, and which may be true, but 20 minutes a day, 20 minutes a day, 20 minutes a day. I have a timer. I don't have it with me. I usually carry it with me everywhere. My phone, but a timer. I set it 20 minutes a day. I set the timer, and I write, write in a notebook. So that's I show up, I sit there.
I love it.
I do this or this, and the stuff gets written. It's magical. It really is.
Yeah, and you use music, or you're a musician?
I'm a musician, I have a band.
You have a band?
In my spare time. It's amazing. Yeah, I have a band. I do.
And you write songs?
I write songs, I sing songs, and I play guitar. And I'm actually also learning the violin because my son is learning the violin and I have to learn it with him. Anyway, long story.
But I asked because also the language is musical, yeah. Right? So are you hearing the language as music?
Mm-hmm. It's sung, right? I mean, do you hear your language as music? Is it like, it's sung. They could sing it, you know?
I think a lot of times when I hear language, I think of, I write in community, so I kind of feel like I'm never writing alone.
Uh-huh.
I'm always write with community people.
Right.
And the community is the poetry of our people.
Oh, yeah.
So, right? So we speak Spanglish, and Spanglish has a rhythm,
uh-huh.
Right?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And so that's how I find the rhythm of the play. But I'm wondering, because you know music so well, if you feel like it's like hitting notes.
Well, what I wonder is, do you find the rhythm first, and do the words come later? You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Because what happens, I find the rhythm first. I can tell you, I know the rhythm, and then the words will come second. Mm. Yeah, so a lot of times, my first drafts are just all the wrong words, in all the wrong places. Doesn't matter, make it better later. Who cares?
So you were like really writing the song.
Yeah. So it's the rhythm. And it's interesting. And I didn't think anything of it until I heard my son learn to speak. And I don't know, those of you who are parents, or your parents, when your kids learn to speak, my son was like, and then gradually, I don't know, Mom, I don't know what I'm going to do. And the words come later, but the rhythm of the language is what he learned to, what he began to imitate initially. So it was like, wow, that's how I write, man. I was like so excited. So, but that kind of, anyway. Yeah,
but, so then you're trying to find meaning later.
Well, right. Yeah. Or just the right words. The meaning, I think the meaning is a separate thing.
Yeah.
I'm trying to find the right words to present to the actors or to sing if I'm singing a song or in a novel. I also write novels or screenplays or whatever. I'm trying to find the right words. But the meaning to me is something that the scholar or the audiences then bring to it.
Mm.
I wouldn't want to sit here and tell you the meaning of what I'm writing, like what it means and the, you know, big picture meaning, like, you know, I don't know the meaning. I know the words though.
And you know the story.
I know the story, exactly. I can tell you the story, but I can't, I'm not really interested in what it means.
Yeah.
Like the psychological or the like the critical analysis thing. The scholars know that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. We leave it to the critics, right?
Well, right, and the scholars who are so invaluable because they are the bridge.
Yeah.
You know, and the audiences have their opinions, which are always interesting. You're laughing like
that. Well, because I wonder what your relationship to the audience is. Do you sit in during previews and listen to them? Do you?
I do, but I write, and I'm going to do something. I write like this. So if this were my desk, I would write like this, meaning I would write with both eyes on the work and no eyes on the audience. Because at any given night, you could have a whole host of different people.
Mm-hmm.
So I really work to hear what the characters want to say, the spirit, and not so much, you know, because for example, we did Father Comes Home from the Wars in LA, and LA, you guys were a great audience. You laughed at every single one of my jokes. I was like, oh man, this is awesome, right? This is amazing. In New York, people are more reserved. Not laughing. They laughed like, you know, 75%. You guys gave me 100% every single joke. It was amazing. So I can't really, you know.
Yes.
I try to write for the work, for the characters, to make sure the characters have their say, you know. And if they're satisfied, then we can, you know, put them to rest and then go on to. That's what I wanted to ask about. We talked about writing something and then putting a character to rest and then going on to another work and only to find that, wait a minute, I still have some more left over that I have to work on with that character, that situation. And you've done it. You were telling
me. Yeah, we were talking about, so I did a Medea called Bruja at the Magic Theater.
Right.
And then it was not the right Medea.
Right.
Now that's a heartbreaking thing because Medea is hard to write.
Right.
And then it's a year of your life. And I knew I was, the critics were very kind, but I knew it was not what I needed to write, right?
Uh-huh.
So then Che Yu, the director, said to me, come to Chicago, but before you rewrite, I want you to go meet the community.
Hmm.
So I went down to the streets at night and started to meet a lot of undocumented people.
Huh.
And then it was clear that I was writing a play about immigration.
Oh, wow.
So then that became Mojada.
Huh.
And that's the much better version of Medea.
Right.
So we talk because fucking A.
Fucking A and In the Blood.
And the Blood. You had the similar, and there's a boat in your story.
There's a boat. So, yes, I was in a canoe.
A canoe.
Yeah, mine is not community, but canoe, which is almost the same thing. I was in a canoe and with a friend who was paddling in the front, and we were somewhere in like Massachusetts. And I said to her in a loud voice, I have to do the gestures because it only works with the gestures. I'm going to write a riff on the Scarlet Letter and I'm going to call it fucking A. And so, and she didn't laugh at all. Again. Yeah, but I got back to land and, you know, you're getting back in land and pulling the canoe ashore or whatever you do. And it still felt like a good idea. You know, even on land, it felt like a great idea. And I thought the first thing I have to do is read the Scarlet Letter, because I hadn't read the Scarlet Letter. So, and then I started writing, and I started writing a play called Fucking A, and it was. I've never had a kidney stone, but I've known men who have had kidney stones, and it felt like the way they describe that feeling. Trying to pass that stone, like roll away the stone, but it's not Jesus, it's a kidney stone. And it's trying to come through. It was so painful. And it was really, 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 really hard to write. And I'm like, gosh, why? And then I said to myself, I'd written a whole draft. And finally, I finally got to the end, which I always do. And then I said, okay, you know, F it, right? We're going to cut everything that's not working. So I started on the last page, which was like page 150 or whatever. And I just said, that's not working, that's not working, that's not working. So I was deleting on my computer. Delete, 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 delete. I got all the way to the top. I cut the whole play. And I said, the title, Fucking A, still works. I said, okay. I said, so what do I do? This, I'm at my desk and I'm going, what do I do, what do I do, what do I do? And I said, I'll tell you, listen, I'll tell you the story of the play. There are five characters. It's a woman named Hester La Negrita and her five children, and it's called In the Blood. And I wrote In the Blood, then Fucking It was very easy to write. It's just a totally different play. So I have two totally different plays. Funny.
So riffs on the same.
Yeah, but they're like nothing. I mean, yeah. There's just plenty of Scarlet Letter. It's women and children and society and how, you know, all that sort of creates disaster and joy.
This is so much more fun than I thought it was going to be. I'm sort of relaxing as we're going through it.
Did you think I was going to be really serious?
Yeah, I don't know why I thought that.
People think that, though, you know. But there's a joy and a lightness that comes from hearing your call and answering it. There is a joy, you know. This
absolutely. And do you know? Do you think about? When you approach work, do you come into the room with a smile, or do you think about it in that way, like the humility it is?
I always humble.
Yeah.
Sometimes scowling. I'm writing something for Amazon right now. I love the material, I love the characters, but the personalities of the producer personalities can require me to become a ninja daily. This is why we're black. I'm a ninja. And I have to, you know, so sometimes I scowl, you know, I'm real, you know, bitch, but get down to work. And the love I feel for the characters and the possibilities, and it's so cool when you write dramatic writing, because it's not just you have a story to tell, but then you get to hire people. Yeah, you get to like say, come on, you
yes,
know what I mean?
Yes.
You can have a job, you can have a place, you can have a stage, and you can, it's fantastic.
The making of a family, the collaborative nature of our work.
Exactly.
So exciting that it just jumps off the page. Mm-hmm. It's literature, but it also becomes alive. That you hear language in space, the electricity of space, right? I love how theater becomes that we fill space, and mm-hmm. tonight there's length here, right? Mm-hmm. But it has depth,
yeah.
You know? And I think a lot about that, just how language has to travel mm-hmm. and how we have to travel with it, right? Mm-hmm. And so the choice of words, which is one of the things I love about your work so much, it feels like the choice of words are carefully traveling.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that came to you early? When, you know, I'm just so intrigued by your past, because I'm wondering how this started.
Yeah, oh gosh. I started, when I was a kid, I would write like songs, you know, I loved writing songs. And then I was in high school, fast forward, I was in high school, and some of you have heard the story. I had a teacher, went to a lovely high school, but had a teacher who, because I was a poor speller, suggested that I should not become a writer. And this is back when we didn't have computers, yo. And there was no such thing as spell check, you know. So if you were a poor speller, you know, you just looked like a dolt. And I English is weird, yo. I mean, they were like, sound out the word. I'm like, it ain't helping. Anyway, so I was going to go into science because I was really good in physics. I was going to get a degree in physics. And then I read some Virginia Woolf in college. I went to Mount Holyoke College, and I, you know, just felt like, wow, I love literature. So I start, but I didn't love theater. Not at all. You know, no, theater, no, I love literature. Like, you know, novels and things like that. And I saw the theater folks across the green, you know, and they were all like, darling, darling. I was like, that is never going to work for me. But you know, you keep listening to the spirit, and you listen to the bigger voice in the room, right? That's my challenge anyway. Shut up and listen to the bigger voice in the room already. So I took a short story writing class with James Baldwin, who was, yeah, it was amazing. He came to teach at Hampshire College. I got into his class, one of 15 people. And when I read my work, my short stories, I was very like, and then she walked down the road, and I was doing all this shit, man. And he's like, Miss Parks, have you ever thought about writing for the theater? Yeah, so that's how I start. You know, I started writing for the theater because he thought it would be a good idea.
That was in 1983.
That was in 1910, yo.
And did you immediately go into?
No, I mean, I wrote plays, and you know, I mean, I just kind of took the little steps, you know. Didn't go to grad school because I'd had my teacher. See, that's the thing. I was like, I've had such a wonderful teacher, Mr. Baldwin, that I'm just gonna kind of hang out in New York and be wild, and it worked out all right. So, but the language thing. But you said language travels. You know, it needs to travel this way, and it also needs to travel through time.
Absolutely.
You know, because what we write in 1990 needs to be still. It needs to be vigorous and long lasting. They're complex.
Yeah.
Carbohydrates, you know what I mean? And they're, again, it's like broccoli. You want to write words like that that are going to really work 20, 30 years from now, you know, should someone pick up your play and want to do it, you know?
And is that why you're drawn to history as well?
Well, it's interesting. The half-life of a historical moment, like half-life, like nuclear, you know, like uranium, the half-life of uranium, you know, things that don't leave us.
Yeah.
I think maybe some events have longer half-lives than others, and so they're still in the groundwater. You know, certain people, like Lincoln, for me, keeps coming back. I don't know why, but there he is. I had a dream once of him. We were dancing. this is such a long time. This is before I wrote Topdog. We were dancing, and he said, "I have to go." It was a garden party, and he said, "I have to go back to see if there's any nation left."
Mm.
And there he went. And it was like, yeah, okay. So, you know, I mean, whatever that meant. But again, who knows what it meant? I'll tell you, yeah.
Well, I just love it because in some ways, history is also the shell that allows us to stay eternal, right? Or in some way move through these times, right? By holding on to something from the past.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to ask you about this notion of home as well, because one of the things I'm so impressed with is, so when you left LA, you went to the Public Theater, right?
Yeah.
And Suzan-Lori is known as the master chair, or the master writer chair.
I know, isn't that great?
At the Public Theater in New York City, and I love that. But I love the idea of what you're doing there, which is not only to write, but you have people come and watch you write, and then you talk to people about their writing.
Yeah.
So is this a form of like literary therapy? What is it, like, how would you describe the experience of it?
Well, it could be. The way I thought of it, years ago, like, we've been doing it for 7 years. It's called Watch Me Work. I have it written on my hand just to make sure that I'm, because I always forget to tell people about it, because we live stream. So the takeaway is that if you'd like to if you have questions about your creative process and you'd like to talk to me in the future, you tune in to Watch Me Work, which is online, and I'll answer them. So anyway, but someone suggested, they were having a theater festival, and they said, hey, we're having a lot of young writers write stuff, and we need something from an old writer. Would you mind? I said, no, I can't. I don't have time to write anything, but, and my mouth kept moving. And nothing, there was nothing in my head, but I said, but I will sit on stage with my typewriter and write for 20 minutes and then talk to the audience about their creative process. And wow. I'll call it Watch Me Work. And I looked at him, and he's like, oh, shit, that'd be great. So Jesse Alec, the literary manager of the Public Theater. So we started doing it, and we have been doing it in the lobby of the Public Theater for 7 years. On Mondays, it's on Mondays at 5 p.m. East Coast time.
And you're completely loyal to it.
Oh, yeah, and it's great. It's like we sit and write, and then people like will say, so, and you'll say, I have a question. My characters never seem to want to do what I want. You know, we'll just talk about what it's like to work with characters or what it's like to work with plot, or if you want to write, if you're writing a play in verse, or you're not even writing a play, you have an architecture project, and you're working on that. So it's not just limited to writing. Mm-hmm. It's all kinds of work. How to manage childcare and, you know, work. How to go dating and still get your writing done. I mean, we talk about everything, but it's all in the context of work. Because they're really, it's just like, how do we keep going? How do we keep going and not go crazy? How do we maintain community? The basic questions, you know.
I was going to ask you also about this. Because so much of what you do is teach, right? You're teaching at work,
yeah.
But you also have a NYU, and then you were at CalArts here with us for a while. And then I just wonder, has your teaching practice changed as you've matured as an artist, or have you this journey that you've gone on, this professional journey in the theater?
Wow. I think I've gotten more sure about the thing that I can bring, which is the ability to hold space. And encourage, right? And so, I mean, I think when I started teaching, I needed to fill every moment in the classroom with exercises and whatnot. And now I've really, in the past 10 years or so, I know that if I, again, show up and hold space for the students, and like you do when your child doesn't know how to walk yet, come on, you can do it, come on. Oh, looking good. My students will learn, because the page is going to teach you. The canvas is your teacher. Hmm. You know, I'm just the person who holds space so that you can hear the canvas talking, or the page talking, you know, or the dance movement talking, or however, you know, and that's my job as a teacher. Hmm. So that's the exercise. That's the exercise that I give over and over and over, and that's the only exercise I give. Show up and do your thing. And then if you need to talk to me about it, we'll talk you through, you know.
I'm wondering if that's a bit like what's going on in the theater too, that you're also holding space, because our numbers in the theater in terms of diversity, in terms of women writing in the theater,
right.
You know, especially in the regional theater. Mm-hmm. Do you think about holding space in the same way? I mean, I saw a beautiful picture of you in Lynn Nottage this year, right? Because she had that beautiful play Sweat.
And
But, you know, it feels like we're also waiting for a moment to happen, a real moment to fill space. And just in terms of who gets to be in the room, do you think about that at all in the same way that you teach?
Yeah, but I don't think we're waiting for a moment. I think we know that the moment is now. It is now, you know. We don't. You know what I mean? We are here.
Yeah.
And we are. It might not be. The circumstances might not be perfect, but they were never perfect, nor will they ever be perfect. Don't wait for perfect. Now is the moment. You know what I mean? And yes, there women might be underrepresented in you know, CEOs of awesome companies, or on stage, or as writers, or as directors. totally true. But let us remember that what we need to do is do our best work, regardless of the circumstances. Sometimes the circumstances are not really in our control, and so I work to take care of the things I can take care of, which is I need to do my best writing, and I need to show kindness to every person I meet. And if I can do that, then that is my job.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
I want to ask you also about this extraordinary project called 365 Days, 365 mm-hmm. Plays, in which you dared and did. You wrote 365 plays.
One a day, though. I did not all on one day. One a day. And it, yeah, I wrote a play a day for a whole year. It was after I won the Pulitzer. It was in 2002 or 2003. And I wanted, you know, it was a way of saying thank you. Theater had suddenly given me a great gift. And I was like, I want to say thank you. How do I say thank you? By showing up. Okay, I'll show up every day. And I'll let go of the need to be brilliant. You know, you get a MacArthur Genius Award, and you think, oh, gosh, what am I going to do? I'm going to show up. I'm going to show up every day. And so some of the plays are gorgeous and lovely, and some of the plays are called, like, This Is Shit. And going through the motions. I mean, there are a lot of plays that are just like, but it's not about, you know, writing the next Topdog Underdog. It's about showing up and saying thank you mm-hmm. to the craft. And so I wrote a play a day. And yeah, we'll do it in the signature season. We'll do a 24-hour immersion of it. So that's going to be fun. So sleeping bags.
And the way it manifested also is that tons of companies around the U.S.
Around the world.
Did these plays.
Yeah.
And did you get to see many of them?
Yeah, we flew. Oh, there were some awesome groups in L.A. They started, Bart DiLorenzo directed
the opening on the
plaza. It was gorgeous. And then what we did is we called all our friends. I worked with the producer, Bonnie Metzger. We called all our friends, and they called all their friends. And suddenly we had connections in Beijing, Minneapolis, Annapolis, Austin, Boston, Sydney, Berlin, you name it. We had a group everywhere all around the world. And we started in November, and we just did them as best we could. It was like, do them as best you can, and we'll scrape together money for a plane ticket and show up and say hi. And that's what we did kind of for a whole year. It was crazy.
I have to say that I work with a small company in East LA called East LA Rep, and it changed that company in an extraordinary way.
Yeah.
Not only to do it, but to meet you, but to also do something that wasn't of the community, but of the community, right?
Yeah.
And to present it. They think they did it out in front of the MTA Plaza, Mariachi Plaza.
Yeah, uh-huh.
How cool.
But it was great to just see who our friends are. And it was like everybody. And so that question again that we started in the beginning, who are you to me? Oh, your family. Oh, we can work with that, you know? So it was a joyous project.
I also want to ask you, there's so much I want to ask and time's going really quick, but I want to ask you about adaptation because do you want a Tony for Best Revival of Porgy and Bess? Just that little Porgy and Bess.
Porgy and Bess, yeah.
Could you tell us some of that experience? Because it sounded phenomenal.
Yeah.
Complicated
and phenomenal. Diane Paulus, who is the artistic director of ART, American Repertory Theater, in Cambridge. So they're connected to Harvard University. She called me up one day and said, I'd like to do an adaptation of the Gershwin's Porgy and Bess. The Gershwin Estate wants me to do it because it's an opera. It's a 3+ hour opera with a huge cast, you know. And she says the Gershwin Estate wants to kind of refashion it to be a traditional musical. You know, two acts like that, and numbers and character development in that kind of way. And she said, so I'd like you to, you know, do the book, adapt the book. And I said, sure. And she said, have you ever listened to it or seen it? I said, no, but I'm going to do it. It's funny because it was one of those musicals that I didn't want to watch. It was, you know, that film of Sidney Poitier, you know, that late night film on the Late Late Show that your parents are watching. And I'm like, I don't like that. So I thought, sure, I'll, you know. But we worked very closely with the Gershwin Estate, and the idea was to make something that would, you know, just carry it forward into the musical theater setting. I think we did a great job. Some people they got their panties in a twist over it. Some got their panties in a twist over it without even having seen it. They decided that Diane Paulus, Deirdre Murray was the composer that she selected to adapt the music and make it suitable for musical theater voices. And I was the book writer she selected. And some people, I think, decided that three women had woken up one morning needing to change Porgy and Bess. And there we went, charging forward with our, you know, whatever. I mean, it was just ridiculous. You know, people were very offended early on by the thought that we should touch it when we had been invited by the people who owned it. It's like if you have a beautiful home in Venice Beach and you invite me in, I'd like you to remodel this. There is no toilet in the house. I'm like, yes, I can put a toilet in your house. And that's what I did, basically. I put a toilet in it so that it could be habitable for all time. Well, but you know what I mean, right?
I'm so stealing that.
No, but that's kind of the work I was doing. It's very much, you know, let's make the stairs, you know, workable and usable. I mean, it's not like let's reimagine it and make it politically correct. I mean, politically correct, I'll just say right now, whatever. I don't even know what that means. I don't even know what that means. Let's make it real. Let's make the characters real. Let's make the characters people. Let's make the characters that actors and actresses will say, wow, I really want to play that role. You know, let's make the characters like that. You know, so it's we did a wonderful job. They loved what we did. They loved what we did. And I loved working with them, actually. They were way cool to work with. And Diane Pauls did a great job.
So. One of the great directors.
Yeah.
I want to kind of roll into something else just really quickly, which is I read a beautiful interview that you did where somebody asked you, why should we listen? And it was a little bit of an attack, like, why should we listen to your story? And you talked about this interconnectedness. Do you remember that? but it was you had a beautiful response that we were all connected, and that something that artists do is we listen to the zeitgeist or what's out in the world,
right.
And then in some way we're translating for everybody
right.
the story that we should all be listening to of this
right.
time.
Right.
Do you feel that way still, or do you think?
I wish I could remember the quote. Very much so. Now, much more than ever, it is our charge. It is our calling. It's your calling. The Spirit, and it's not about God and the church. The Spirit, the great thing, you know, that is bigger than you, right? If you want to call it community, call it community. If you want to call it family, if you want to call it just that feeling you get when you're in the woods, or that feeling you get when you're on a desert plain and you go, wow, right? That big thing is calling out to you, and it is your responsibility to listen to it. And it's something that we all share, regardless of race or persuasion or ethnicity or all those things that we think make us different. That's just a play of the mind, right? So it's now more than ever. Now more than ever, we live in challenging times, and challenging times are opportunities for us to rise up and hear the calling. The Spirit is calling, saying, hey, we are wonderful together.
Thank you, first of all, Tom, so much for being here. It's been I'm so inspired by you, and it's always great to be with you in the room with you. Thank all of you for sharing this moment with us.
Yay!
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcast.usc.edu. And for more programming from the USC Arts and Humanities Initiative, go to visionsandvoices.usc.edu.